Tell me about your first, I'm sure you remember it vividly, but the first time that you strapped on a guitar and went up in a coffee house scene, or was it an open mic, or what was, tell me about that day.
I went with my friend Jonathan Shambroom, who actually lives in the Bay Area, and he's a real Renaissance man. So he was learning guitar, and he said, "We got to go to this open mic." And so we went, and this really great person played, and I said, "I can't do it." And I crossed my name off. And he's like, "Well, I'm gonna go." And he went up and he played. He'd been playing for like a year, and he had an instrumental, and it was lovely. And so so the next week I was like, "Well, okay, I'll play." And it went really well. And it was a place called the Naked City Coffee House. And there was this guy who had this really Jesus thing, big hair, big beard, named Chris Dunn, very laid back, never had a negative word to say for anybody, really established this very lovely vibe, who, introduced me. And I played my songs, and he said, "You write those?" And I said, "I did."
Now, so you come up in kind of a supportive scene like that, and you kind of get a sense like, okay, I can, this is really happening, and I can really do it. What was the moment as a songwriter where you felt, I might be able to really parlay this into something bigger than just a coffee house sort of support community?
Well, there was this, it was funny, off on the periphery, you'd see things happening for, Jonathan Brook was going to open for John Gorka at the Unitarian Church. And, you'd hear sort of these next steps that people would be making of opening for really impressive people who were, who were making a living. And I think I almost quit after a year because amidst all the fun and support, there was a lot of pettiness, which I now realize was very important too. Like, that's okay. We were all sleeping together, and it was petty and jealous and sexist, and all those things that you think, oh, that's so terrible. Well, it's part of the mix. I mean, of course, you're going to have guitar dudes who tell you to quit or, at least stop playing guitar. And of course, you're going to get women who say weird stuff that hits you in the gut an hour after they said it. You're like, what? And,
Is there anything that strikes that jumps out in your memory as one of those kick you in the gut kind of comments?
I went out with somebody who said, if there's anything else you can do, is there anything else you can do? And, he knew that the answer would be yes. I was like, yeah, I would love to be a religion professor, a psychologist. He said, "Do it then, because this is what I have to do. And if you don't have to do this, don't do it." And so anyway, he's not
He's not in
doing
the
it
picture anymore.
anymore. And he's a really happy guy and everything's fine. But I remember that being like, quit now. If you can, then leave, because I can't. So yeah. And I actually got a couple of those, a couple of feedback moments like that. And but I, it was such a great, it was like a true rainforest. You had the little plants of the open mics, and you had the tip jar gigs, the opening slots. And then you had someone like John Gorka, who wrote a song called Gravyland. And just when I thought, I just have to quit because I don't have the ambition to do this. I mean, I love it, and I always take the next step. That's what I'm able to do. But John wrote a song called Gravyland, where he said, "I wrote this because I'm had a much lower bar starting out than I hit. So the rest has been gravy." And I thought, he just spoke to me. And John Gorka is such a, honest soul. And as soon as I heard that song, I said, okay, that's what I'm going to emulate. And then I did it. And then taking one step at a time was a fine way to live out your ambition.
And was what was the moment where you said, well, this is really going to come
This
true.
is
This
it.
is going to happen, at least for a little while, right?
The day the Honesty Room came out was at the Iron Horse, and the album was express mailed to the Iron Horse in Northampton, Massachusetts. And the crowd was, it was a full crowd. And I knew most of them, and I lived there. But it was still, there was this kind of heightened feeling, and I made money. And then a month later, I went to this thing called Folk Alliance, which is like a
Oh, yeah.
convention. Yeah, so, but
Oh,
with a convention with guys with long beards. jamming in with violins in the lobby, and I thought, this is going to be terrible because all my ex-boyfriends are going to be there, and and they're all going to be, you know, and then I'm going to have this little album, but you know, this will help me tour. Right. You know, if I can give this to one radio person from Nebraska, that will help me because I'll be able to get a gig in California and one in New York. So yes. I went to Folk Alliance, and everybody who I ended up working with over the next 5 years was there at this one showcase that I did at 1 o'clock in the morning, and some of the biggest self-appointed boosters mm-hmm. of acoustic music. And then at the end of the week, Bob Jones of Newport mm-hmm. said, I'll do that. I have this thing, I have a slot, it's 15 minutes, I'm gonna give one to you, one to Richard Chindell, and one to Ellis Paul, and we're gonna do it.
Nice.
So by the end of, I remember walking back to my room, you know, going home and seeing my room, and my room didn't look the same to me. I mean, that weekend, everything changed. So this is a song that's in Dadgad, and it's called When I Was a Boy. So it was, lyrically, it was basically the song that launched my career. And for anyone who's interested in songwriting as well as acoustic guitar playing, I have to say that kind of weird, I'm just writing this for me, and I'll write it for the archives, and people might not get it. That feeling can sometimes mean that you are going to write a song that no one's gonna like, but sometimes it means you're writing someone that just people were waiting for someone to write, and that just turned out to be When I Was a Boy. I had a great friend who told me that basically if you bar, you know, the top two strings here, and basically cover the three low strings, that you're just gonna, it's gonna do something cool. So you're gonna see a lot of that in my playing. Also, my friend had a special capo that she made that would do certain, you know, that would cordon off these three strings. She learned that from David Wilcox, I think. So I have Jamie Morton and David Wilcox to thank for this song.
I won't forget when Peter Pan came to my house, took my hand. I said I was a boy, I'm glad he didn't check. I learned to fly, I learned to fight. I lived a whole life in one night. We saved each other's lives out on the pirate deck. And I remember that night when leaving a late night with some friends, and I hear somebody tell me it's not safe, someone should help me. I need to find a nice man to walk me home. When I was a boy, I scared the pants off of my mom, climbed what I could climb up. Oh, oh, oh. And I don't know how I survived, I guess I knew the tricks that all boys knew. Small boy on her bike, riding topless, yeah, I never cared who saw. My neighbor came outside to say, get your shirt. I said, no way, it's the last time, I'm not breaking any law. And now I'm in this clothing store, and the signs say less is more. More that's tight means more to see, more for them, not more for me. That can help me climb a tree. seconds flat when I was a boy. See that picture, that was me. Grass stained shirt and dusty knees. And I know things have gotta change. They got pills to sell, they got implants to put in. They got implants to remove. Step when I'm being caught off guard. I've had a lonesome, awful day. The conversation finds its way to catching fireflies out in the backyard. And so I tell the man I'm with about the other life I lived. And I say, now you're Top Gun. I have lost and you have won. Says, oh no, no, can't you see? When I was a girl, my mom and I, we always talked, and I picked flowers everywhere that I walked. And I could always cry. Now even when I'm alone, I seldom do.
Tell me about this guitar, this Collings Cutaway. How did you come upon this guitar?
This is from a store called the Music Emporium in Lexington, mm-hmm. Massachusetts, which I should mention because it's very, very good. I had been playing Larrivées, mm-hmm. which I loved, and I had a very small body one. But once in around Christmas time in 2006, I went up to do a gig, and I had my son with me to drop off my mother-in-law's house in Boston, and had him and his bottles and, you know, whatever, you know, rags and his clothes and his toys and, you know, all my makeup bag and not my guitar. So I opened up the trunk and knew immediately what I'd done, and I had to get a guitar immediately. So they lent me one in Portland, and then I borrowed Peter Mulvey's from where it was getting fixed in Lexington, Massachusetts, and they said, well, why don't you try a few guitars while you're here? You know, we could lend you one or Peter's. And so we took some off the wall, and I just loved them and said I would come back, and I came with my husband. And both of us are so, you know, willing to not see ourselves as real virtuosos that we were like, that sounds good, that sounds good. And they took this one off, and we both said, oh no, that's it.
Yeah.
Like, what, you know? It's like the Prius of guitars. Why would you not?
Right.
It's completely reliable. And the thing that I like about it is that the cutaway, actually, you don't sacrifice any sound for some mm-hmm. reason. So, but mm-hmm. it, for a woman's body, it really works better.
And earlier you were demonstrating a little humidifier trick there. you're a walking humidifier, it turns
this,
out.
This works so well, better than any humidifier I've ever used, and less drippy and messy. I go like this. And then the air that comes back to me is dry, and when I finally have a breath that goes in that comes back feeling humid, I know that I'm done for the day. And you know, sometimes I'll get off a plane and I just can't get it tuned up on stage, and I'll breathe into it like that, and then it's better, you know. I mean, it still gets mad that I took it on a plane, but it actually, you know, brightens its mood. And then, you know, if I do that a few times in a trip, it's all I've ever needed.